The following is a class on the Bhagavad Gita as it is, 4th chapter, text 19 through 22, given by His Divine Grace A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada, recorded in July of 1966 in New York.
Yasya sarvi samarambhya kama sankalpa buddhita jnanagni dagdha karmana तमाहु पंडितं बुधा सत्या कर्म फला संगम नित्त तृप्त निराश्रय कर्मणि अभिप्रवृत्तोपि नैव किंचित् करोति सः. Now, how one can work without any lust? This process is being described by Sri Krishna to Arjuna. In our last meeting, we have discussed the previous verse that we may begin any gorgeous task, it doesn't matter. But we have to work in Krishna consciousness, not for sense gratification. That will make us free from the interaction of the activity. So long we are attached to work for sense gratification, so long we shall be under the obligation of reaction. Now, if we want to get out of the reaction of material activity, then this is the formula given by Sri Krishna, kama sankalpa buddhita. Kama means one sense gratification. I want to do this thing for my sense gratification. That is material. But if I want to do something which will be satisfactory, which will be satisfaction to Krishna, that is Krishna consciousness. This very simple thing we are discussing in a different way. And this Krishna consciousness is attained by jnanagni dagdha karmana. Yes?
Look, from this angle, it's the same as broken.
No.
Just the
answer. Just like if a fire burns everything, similarly, when we act in Krishna consciousness, after attainment of full knowledge of Krishna consciousness, then just like fire burns everything, similarly, the reaction of our activity will be burned. Jnanagni dagdha karmana. This verse we have already discussed, and the next verse is further explanation of this verse. Tatya karma phala sangam nitta tripta nirashre. Now, whatever we do, we deserve some fruit out of it. Anything we do, we expect some result out of it. Sometimes the result may be bad, or sometimes the result may be very good. But a person in Krishna consciousness should not be attached either to the good result or bad result. Because even if I want good result, that is my attachment. And of course, if there is bad result, we haven't got any attachment, but sometimes we lament. That is our attachment. That is our attachment. So, one has to transcend both from the good result and the bad result. How it can be done? It can be done. Just like if you are working on account of some big firm. Suppose you are a salesman. You are working on behalf of that big firm. Now suppose if you make $1 million profit, you have no attachment for that because you know that this profit goes to the proprietor. You have no attachment. Similarly, if there is some loss, you also know that I have nothing to do with the loss. And it goes to the proprietor. Similarly, if we work on account of Krishna, then I shall be able to give up the attachment for the result of the war. Chakta karma phala sangam nitta tripta nirashraya. Nitta tripta, always satisfied. Either there is good result or there is bad result. It doesn't matter. I shall remain satisfied in the sense that I am working under the direction of Krishna. So, I have nothing to think of the reason. Tammanne vadikarasti maphale svadasi. Just like Arjuna. Arjuna did not like to fight with his relatives, with his grandfather. But because Krishna wanted it, he fought and he was satisfied. Because the principle was that Krishna wants it and Krishna is satisfied. Although I do not like to fight, but Krishna is satisfied, therefore I have to fight. This is Krishna consciousness. Nitta tripta. He is not dissatisfied. No, oh, I have to fight against my relatives, my grandfather, my teacher. Nirasa. Nirasa means he is not under the obligation of any good result or bad result. Nirasa. In this way, if we engage ourselves in any activity, karmani abhipravittopi, if one is engaged in such a spirit of neutrality, simply for the satisfaction of Krishna, then the result will be karmani abhipravittopi, although he is engaged in every sort of work, naiva kinti karoti sa. He is free from that work. He is free from the result or reaction of such work. So, this is the process that we have simply to act in Krishna consciousness by doing so, the reaction of such work will not affect you. Nirashi jagacittatma tatta sarva parigraha sariram kevalam karma kurban nahnati kinvisham. Kinvisham. Kinvisham means sin. We are materially so much entangled that even if we do not want to commit any sin, consciously or unconsciously, we are obliged to commit some sort of sin. We are in such a circumstances. Say for example, just like animal killing. Animal killing according to Buddhist philosophy or even according to Hindu philosophy, animal killing is a sort of sin. Now suppose I I am not inclined to kill animals, or I do not kill animals. I avoid it. But intentionally or unintentionally, sometimes we have to kill animals. How is that? Now suppose we are walking on the street, there are many ants who are being killed by the pressure of our legs. Unintentionally. Now, and suppose, of course here, we have got gas oven, but in India, they have got ordinary country oven, and that is washed daily. And sometimes in the oven, some small germs and flies, they take shelter. But when you go fire the oven, they die. So that is intention. Sometimes you keep the jug of water, and within the underneath the jug of water, there are many, small germs and flies that take shelter. But when you take the jug, they are killed. In this way, there are so many processes, unintentionally or intentionally, we have to kill. But they are taken into account. They are also seen. According to strict Vedic literature, if you kill even a bug, you are sinful. You cannot kill even a bug. These are mentioned in the scripture. Now, how we can avoid? How we can avoid? That is it. I do not like to kill, but sometimes unintentionally they are killed. Therefore, according to Vedic literature, there are five kinds of yoga performed to get oneself free from this unintentional killing of animals. Now here Krishna says, the sarirang kevalam karma kurbannapi kurban napnoti kilmisham. If you make your principle of life that I have to work simply for maintaining my body and soul together. Sarirang. Sarirang means body. Because I have to execute, I have to understand Krishna consciousness. But without this body, how can I understand or culture Krishna consciousness? So my body must be maintained. And if I want to maintain my body, intentionally or unintentionally, I have to commit so many things. Let's take for example, those who are vegetarians, they may think that we are not killing animals. No, they are also committing sins. Because vegetables, they are also got life. So, the nature's law is that to keep up your body, you have to kill another body. Never mind it is vegetables or, animals or some fish or something else. Okay? Jiva jivasya jivanam. One living entity is the subsistence, life-giving subsistence for another living being. That is the nature's law. You'll find, ahastani sahastana. Everything has been very nicely discussed in Vedic literature. They have discussed all the points. Ahastani sahastanam. Those who have got hands, they are eating, and living entities who have no hands. That means we are human beings, we have got hands, and we are eating animals. They have got only legs, they have no hands. So, ahastanam sahastanam ahastani. Those who have got hands, they are eating the animals which have no hands. And apadani chatuspadam, those who have no legs, they are being eaten by the four-legged. Just like a cow eating grass. The grass cannot move, it has life, but it cannot move. So, and apadanam sapadani. Nunang mahadam tatra, nunang, those who are weak, they are being eaten by the just like fine lizards. In your country, you don't find lizards. In India, we have got many lizards in the world. They are eating small ants. Nunang mahadam tatra. And in the snake kingdom, you find the small snakes are being by the big snake. Similarly, in sea water also, you will find small fishes are being eaten by the big fishes. And the same law is applicable in human society. A big nation is trying to swallow up a small nation. You see? This is going on. This is nature's law. Nature's law. You cannot avoid it. But there are those who are Krishna conscious. It is said that sariram kevalam karma kurban napnati nakshilisham. Those who are in Krishna consciousness, they are not entangled in the sinful act. How? They are also maintaining their body. So, when they are maintaining their body, they have to commit things, they have to eat other animals or vegetables, never mind. So how they are not committing sin? These are very intelligent questions. That there is Krishna consciousness. A devotee of Lord Krishna, he does not eat anything which is not offered to Krishna. Just like you take the remnants of your master, and the servant takes the remnants of your master. The master is in India. The process is the husband and wife. After the husband eats, the remnants are taken by the wife. The wife does not eat along with the husband. That is the old system. Now it is being changed. The husband and wife, they do not. The husband is supplied by the wife all kinds of good dishes. And when the husband is satisfied, some foodstuff is left, and that is taken by the wife. So similarly, a devotee of Krishna, he does not take anything, does not accept anything which is not offered to Krishna. This is the process. Because his life is full of Krishna consciousness. And Krishna says in the Bhagavad Gita, he is fine. Suppose if you want to take things which has been eaten by Krishna, then you have to ask Krishna, what do you desire to eat, sir? Suppose if you want me to feed, give me some foodstuff, naturally you ask me, Swamiji, what sort of foodstuff you like? I have got experience here in your country. I was invited in Butler, here also. By some churches, and they wanted to give me some food. So they asked me, Swamiji, what do you desire to eat? So I told them, I am strictly vegetarian. I shall accept fruits and meat, that's all. Similarly, if anyone invites somebody, it is natural that the guest is asked what sort of foodstuff he would like. Similarly, Krishna, if you want to offer something Krishna, you must know what sort of foodstuff he wants. How will you know? Krishna is not just present in your front. How will you know that Krishna wants this foodstuff? Oh, that is stated in the Bhagavad Gita. Just like you can understand what government expects from me, you can know from the law books, from the civil code. Similarly, what Krishna wants, it is stated in the Bhagavad Gita. Krishna says, patram pushpam phalam toyam yomi bhakta prajakshati tadaham bhakya puritam ashnami puritatmanah. Now, Krishna, the Supreme Lord, he is not hungry. He is not hungry that I shall supply him foodstuff, and therefore he will be maintained. It is not like that, but it's still Krishna saying that patram pushpam phalam toyam jomi bhaktabhinichyati. Any devotee, if he offers me patram, patram means leaf, pushpam means flower, patram pushpam phalam, phalam means fruit, patram pushpam phalam toyam, toyam means milk or water. Generally this means milk, water. Now just see, to satisfy Krishna is not very difficult thing. Even the poorest man in the world, he can satisfy Krishna by these four items. Anyone can secure from any part of the world. It doesn't matter that because Krishna was, Krishna appeared in India, therefore he wanted Indian food. No. The patram pushpam phalam toya, leaf and flower and fruit and water, oh, that is available in America, that is available in Czechoslovakia and Greenland, everywhere. So this is the universal form of satisfying Krishna. Anyone, it doesn't matter, however poor he can satisfy. You do not require, oh, Krishna, the Supreme Personality, Godhead, I have invited him, so I must arrange very nice foodstuff. Of course, if you have got means to supply very nice foodstuff, you must. Otherwise, you will be understood that you are miser. If for your own eating, you prepare very nice dishes, and because Krishna says, I will satisfy with leaf and fruit. So you supply Krishna all like, sir, you take leaf and fruit, and for me, I shall take this palatable dishes. No, Krishna is very, intelligent also. He is more intelligent than, so then you are cheating. It is for thee and the poorest man. If you have got means, in India, there are many thousands of Krishna temples all over India, especially in Vrindavan. I have several times told you that Vrindavan is a city only 50,000 people, not even 100,000, 50,000 people is a small city. But there are 5,000 temples. Five all Krishna temples. Now each and every temple you will find how nice food, according to the capacity of the temple owner. Costly foodstuffs are being offered, and those foodstuffs is distributed among the poor classes. Now at the present moment, after the we have got Swaraj or independence, the government has interfered with this sort of service. They say that this is waste of money. Why you are offering? They are becoming atheists. But this is not waste of money. At the cost of the rich man, the prasadam was being distributed to the poor class of man at a nominal cost. Now poor man, they go to hotel. But if they take prasadam in a temple, the far better quality foodstuff is supplied to him only at nominal cost. In the hotel, what will be charged? $1. He can have it in the temple for 10 cents. So this is so much saying. In our childhood, when I was a boy of 8 or 10 years, sometimes I used to accompany my father. My father was a great devotee. He would take prasadam from the temple. So I got experience that we paid for 2 dishes, 4 annas. 4 annas means, according to modern extent, it is 5 cents. 5 cents according to your exchange value. Now for 5 cents we have very nice prasadam. We can get 2 persons to your table. Still there is a place which is called Nathadwara. Nathadwara, if you pay there 2 and a half, you will get what prasadam? $2 now. So this system is going on still. So if one has got sufficient means, he should supply Krishna to his best capacity. But when Krishna wants that you give me, he says, this is the lowest common factor. Patram Pushvam Phalam Toya. Anyone, any poor man in any part of the country, they can supply Krishna and take the prasadam. So now by taking that prasadam, you become free from the responsibility of being sinful. That is this point. That way you will find in Bhagavad Gita that Jagnyasista Sino Santa Muchante Sarvakimishai. If you take the remnants after offering Krishna, that pushka makes you free from all kinds of sin. So anyone, it doesn't matter what he can prepare pushka either family wise or just like I am here single, cooking my foodstuff and I am offering my Krishna and I am taking and as far as possible some of the remnants is distributed to the devotees. So this process we can adopt everyone because we have to maintain this body. So if we do not take Krishna prasad, then I become responsible for all kinds of sins. But if you take, accept Krishna prasad, then I have no responsibility. Because Krishna is taking, just like Arjuna is fighting, Arjuna is afraid of sinful acts by killing his kinsmen and the grandfather. But when he understood that I am fighting on Krishna's account, so I am free. Sariram kevalam karma kurvan na apnoti kirmisam. If you simply don't try to increase your artificial demands for maintaining this body, you have every right to live. And everyone has got right to live. Not only myself, even the ant has got the right to live. But in a human society, by our so-called civilization, we give all protection to the human society, but we don't give any protection to the animal society. Because it is due to want of Krishna consciousness. When we shall be Krishna conscious, then naturally we shall feel for every living entity, because we shall know. Because in the Bhagavad Gita it is stated, Mamaivamsa Jiva Loke Jiva Bhuta Sanatana. All these living entities, they are all my fragments. They are parts and parcels of Krishna. Under circumstances, some of them have become lower animals, some of them have become big men, some of them have demigods, some of them become small germs. It doesn't matter. But they are all parts and parcels of Krishna. So a person who is under Krishna consciousness, he cannot make any injustice to any living entity. That is Krishna consciousness. Therefore, one who has dedicated his life for acting on account of Krishna, under Krishna consciousness, nirasi jata cittatma. He has no other hope except, save and except, to satisfy Krishna. Nirasi jata cittatma tatta sarva parigraha. He doesn't like to exploit the resources of the material nature. Whatever is up there, and easily gets that nature, he accepts, and he maintains his body and soul together, and for Krishna satisfaction, and he eats everything which is offered to Krishna, then he is free from all kinds of sinful reactions. By the next log, it is more nicely explained. Yadichcha lavasantushya dandatita vimatsaraha sama siddhyava siddhauca kritiyati na nibandhate. Now the process of life describes here. Yadichcha lavasantushya. One should be satisfied with things which comes very easily. We should not try for anything too much to obtain it. No. We shall be satisfied. Whatever comes automatically or by the will of Krishna, we may be satisfied in that way. Yadichchala. For gaining something, we should not be too much endeavored. Then I shall be deviated from Krishna consciousness. There are six formulas which can deviate us from Krishna consciousness. And there are six formulas which can encourage us, which can enhance, advance us in Krishna consciousness. And what are they? Now, first of all, let me say, what are against principles, against Krishna consciousness, against the principle of Krishna consciousness? What are they? Pratyahara priyasasya prajalpa niyamagraha lounam janasangasya karadhi bhakti pranashyati. Karadhi bhakti pranashyati. Pranashyati means is lost. Krishna consciousness is lost. How? By these six processes. What are these six processes? Pratyahara. Pratyahara means to eat more than what you require. And uttara means to accumulate wealth more than what you require. The whole trouble of the world is that nobody is satisfied. If he is a poor man, if he thinks, my income is $100, if I get $400 per month, then I will be very happy. But when he gets $400, we expect, if I get $1,000, then I shall be happy. In this way, it is going on. Nobody is satisfied. But here it is said, yadichcha lavasantushya. That automatically comes. As we make progress in the matter of Krishna consciousness, then our demand for more enjoyment, for more accumulation of wealth, diminishes. That is a symptom of Krishna consciousness. Yadichcha lavasantushya. Uttyahara means to acquire more than we need. Because we have to maintain this body and soul together, then we must earn something or acquire something to keep my health and body fit. That is all right. But we should not try unnecessarily for accumulating more. Suppose if I am satisfied by some grains and vegetables and fruits and milk, if my health is properly kept, why should I eat more than that? Simply for satisfying the palate, my tongue. No, we should not do that. So that is chalava santushya. So uttyahara, to accept more than what we need, that is against Krishna consciousness. And prayasa. Prayasa means we have to acquire something. But if it requires a heavy work, endeavor, we should avoid it. Uttyara prayasasya prajalpa. Prajalpa means for nothing talking nonsense. People are accustomed to talk so many things unnecessarily. Just in class, among friends circle, which has no benefit either spiritually or materially. So such thought of dropping should be avoided. Satyahara Prayasasya Prajalpa Niyamagraha. Niyamagraha means to stick to the rules, regulations. Suppose in your faith or in my faith there are certain rules and regulations to be observed. But if I go to some other place where the rules and regulations cannot be strictly observed, and if I want to observe such rules and regulations, then my main business is suffering. So we should not stick to the rules and regulations, we should stick to the business. Just like I'm an Indian sannyasi, I come to a country, to your country. Oh, there are many rules and regulations in India. It is different from your rules and regulations. But if I follow, if I stick to rules and regulations of India and conception, then it is impossible to remain here. So I have to propagate this mission, Krishna consciousness. So I am not so much attached to the rules and regulations, but I am attached to the preaching work. So therefore, Niyamagra, Uttyahara Prayasasya Prajalpa Niyamagra, this Niyamagra is also against Krishna consciousness. And Niyamagra also. And when you are in convenient position, if you do not observe the rules and regulations, that is also against Krishna consciousness. Uttyahara Prayasasya Prajalpa Niyamagra, Lolam means greediness. That is against Krishna consciousness. Janasangasya. Janasangasya means to associate with persons who are not interested in Krishna consciousness. We should avoid association of persons who are not interested in Krishna consciousness. If we make more association with persons who are not interested in Krishna consciousness, then it will go against me. So these are six against rules. Similarly, there are six favorable rules. What are they? Utsahat, Vajjat, Nishtayat, Tattat Tatma Pravartanat, Sato Vitti, Sadhu Sangve, Saraji Bhakti Prasiddhati. Prasiddhati means it flourishes. The cause is advanced. How? Utsahat. We should be very much enthusiastic. How? Krishna consciousness is so nice. We have heard about Krishna consciousness, so nice thing. It is so beneficial for successful human mission. So I must have it. I must execute this Krishna consciousness. This is called usaha. To become energy. Not lethargic, but energy. So usaha dhajjat. Dhajjat means with patience. Suppose I have begun immediately, so if there are so many impediments, I am not immediately successful. Oh, that doesn't matter. I must be patient. Uttaha, dhajja, nishchaya. Nishchaya means with confidence. Confidence. Because Krishna says, this is this. So I must have confidence. So Krishna says like this. So it is sure to be successful. I must have that confidence. Sutta, dhajja, nishyat, and tattat karma pravartana. And you have to do, you have to act accordingly, as Krishna says. If you do not act, then tattat karma pravartana, sato vritti, and your profession should be very honest. Sato vritti and sadhu sangha, and you should associate, just like the against rule is to associate with persons who are not Krishna conscious. Similarly, sadhu sangha. Sadhu sangha means, sadhu means who are culturing the Krishna consciousness. They are called sadhu. You'll find in the Bhagavad Gita. Apite sudurachara bhajati mamanannabha sadhu reyo samantabha. About sadhu, I will explain several times. So sadhu sangha, we have to make association with persons who are spiritually interested and who are trying to culture Krishna consciousness, that association. So these six things will elevate me to the path of Krishna consciousness, and the other six formulas, they go against me. So, Jadrichhalava Santushta means that my principle should be how to excel, how to become successful in Krishna consciousness in this life, and so far other things are required for maintaining my body, I shall be satisfied. Whatever easily comes by the will of the Supreme Lord, I should accept. I should not make much endeavor for artificial fulfillment of our desires and senses. So, Jadrichhalava Santushta Dandatita. Dandatita means he should avoid worldly. Because this world is full of, especially this age, people are seeking how to quarrel, you see. So we have to avoid quarrel, you see. Dandatita Vimasara. And we should not be envious. Sometimes we are faced with persons who are envious to us. But we should not be envious. It's just like the best example is Lord Jesus Christ. His enemies who crucified him, they are envious of Jesus Christ. But Lord Jesus Christ was not envious to them. When he was being crucified, he prayed God, "Oh Lord, they do not know what they are doing. Please excuse them." Just think how much, I mean, noble he was. Vimasa, he was not envious to anyone, even to his enemy. The Krishna consciousness teaches us that they are not envious even to the enemy. The Vimasara Sama. Sama means equal to everyone. Siddhya, Siddho, Asiddho. Now suppose that we do not expect in Krishna consciousness, it does not matter. Just like Arjuna was fighting in Krishna consciousness, but his only beloved son, I mean to say Abhimanyu, he was killed there. He was killed there. But because he was fighting, there may be some of my party men, they must be killed. I cannot expect in fighting that I shall be simply victorious and the other party will be killed. No. So, that was a great thought to Krishna Arjuna. He was the only son and he was 16 years old and he had a young wife. But he was steady even at the death of his only son, Siddha Siddho. So Krishna Abhinam Yodhate. In this way, if we let progress Krishna consciousness, then we are free from any reaction of this. This is the whole point.